I don't think you understand what's going on here. If you're not fucking with this, you're not fucking with nothing. What's up everyone? I'm Trey Baird, and this is Majik Ninja Monday, and we're going to review Lex the Hex Master Contact. So stay tuned after the intro. We ain't gonna rob by accident. It's only a select few that can handle this. Freak shit, apparition of a poltergeist. Blessed with a heart, but it's cold as ice. It broke it twice. What is up everyone? As I said, I'm Trey Baird and this is Majik Ninja Monday. And we are checking out the debut full-length album from Lex the Hex Master. Now, when Majik Ninja Entertainment announced this guy, and it was this hard, tough dude with black and white face paint. It's like, this is just like every other Juggalo artist that's ever come around. Twisted said they were doing something different. They were, paving the way and creating the next generation of artists for their label. And then they come out with this, stereotypical Juggalo rapper. What's going on here? Well, I'm sure I wasn't the only person who thought that. And I'm sure I wasn't the only person who was very quickly convinced otherwise. Lex is fire. He's awesome. He reminds me very much of old school ABK, but he has his own style. It's very hard around the edge, rough around the edges. It's very hard. It's very aggressive. And it's very real, but there's still that fantasy element and it just works. And it's the type of product that's best put out by a company like Majik Ninja Entertainment. I just don't see how any other label could have really done this character justice, this artist justice. Someone else could have possibly put him out, but they would have botched it. And the coolest thing is, they didn't really change his persona. And that's what I like about Majik Ninja. They're not trying to reinvent the wheel. They're looking for artists who have something there, and they're just trying to build upon it. Like, they, if I'm not mistaken, they added the Hex to his name. He was originally going by Lex Masters, but from what little of his early content I saw, it's like basically identical to what he's doing now, just with the volume turned up and with a better production value and more regularity to his content, to his music. So, like I said, they didn't change who he is, but I think they added the Hex to his name, Lex the Hex, for marketing purposes, and to just give him a, more of a unique persona. And I like it. I think it's fresh. But today, we're checking out his debut album. Like I said, it's called Contact. Get that without the glare, maybe? There we go, kinda. Yeah, right there. And this is a really good album. He put out an EP before this called The Black Season, which, his debut EP and his debut album, full-length album, they're very different. They each have their own unique style. And as the years gone by and he's put out more and more stuff, I see that he has that time-honored tradition of reinventing himself for every release, but not going so far as to be a completely different artist. And that's what you gotta do to stay relevant. It's one of the 48 laws of power, to constantly reinvent yourself, be unpredictable, don't rehash the same thing. And, Lex has got that down. And this album has a unique personality unto its own. But you got the fresh comic book style art where he's basically sort of, it's like an alien theme, but not really. You got your inner art. Like I always say, Majik Ninja always comes correct with the graphic design. It's just, I love that. That's just so fresh right there. You take off the CD and that's his logo behind there. That full moon. That, It's like, I wish I had thought of that. That is so cool. And I'm glad that M&E still goes all in on their CDs and their packaging, because CDs don't make money anymore. They just don't. And the more you skimp on design and CD booklets, the more money you save, and therefore the less money you lose. Because like I said, nobody makes money on CDs anymore. But I just really love it. Now, this came out during their whole Year of the Sword push, which all of the artists put out an album, at least an album, during the Year of the Sword. Gmoski was, and Lex were kind of the exceptions, because they came out, if I'm not mistaken, this came out in November of the previous year, and Gmoski came out December, but they were still considered Year of the Sword releases. But all of them came with Majik Ninja Entertainment stickers, and they really pushed. Here you go. Just like, focus on these two panels, they really pushed the upcoming album releases. You know, you have your Twisted advert, you have your Gmoski advert, and then they're pushing the Lex the Hex Master merch on Twisted Shop, and of course your liner notes. Pretty standard stuff there. But this is kind of what made Psychopathic a big deal back in the day. Just their synergy, the way they promoted each other, the way they built each other up instead of trying to tear each other down. And that's what Majik Ninja's doing now, and I love it. I love that they're getting back to that, and that it's not just, the company isn't just one big powerhouse marketing campaign for one artist. So let's get going. You know, as I have said many times, I do a numerical rating, 1 to 10 for each track, and then a numerical rating for the album, but it's not necessarily an average of all the scores. You know, the album can be cohesive without having any standout tracks, and the standout tracks can be there but not be cohesive altogether. So, first you have the intro, which is, a lot of their debut LPs on Majik Ninja had a similar intro to this one. Boondocks did one very similar. It's just introducing the character to the audience. It's like a reboot, if you will. And it sets the tone really nicely and goes straight into the second track, Takeover. And what I like about Takeover is that it builds. You know, it's got a good beginning, but then the second track hits and it's just, you know, really going hard, and I love it. And then third track comes and it kind of gives a little crescendo, but it's still hitting hard, and I just love this track. It's a good opening track to the album. 9 out of 10. Next up, Where Was You? And now that Lex has sort of, you know, quote unquote made it, and everybody wants to act like they're his friend, you know, Lex is asking, well, where were you when I needed your help? Where were you when I was paying dues? Now that I'm starting to reap the rewards for where I am, now you want to show up. And I mean, we've heard this type of track before, but it's because it's a common theme. You know, human nature is just like that. It's a common thing for people to come out of the woodwork whenever the dues are paid, whenever the heavy lifting is done, and you start to see rewards for that lifestyle. But it's a good track. It kind of changes the pace of the album, but in a good way. You know, you got all this fantasy element to the album theme, and then all of a sudden it's getting real. And I think that's a nice artistic touch. 9 out of 10. Next up, The Boss, The Teacher, and The Preacher. And here, Lex is going for the jugular. He's showing that, you know, not necessarily a horrorcore artist, but I can do it. I can be just as horrorcore as anyone else on the label, on or off the label for that matter. And it's what it sounds like. You know, each verse is about a different person, the boss, the teacher, and the preacher, and he kills each one on each verse, and it's pretty straightforward, but I like how the beat sort of evolves to suit who he's talking about and what he's talking about. And he doesn't pull any punches in this track. It's very raw. It's very rough. And I wouldn't have it any other way. It's a good track. You know, as far as horrorcore goes, there's certainly better out there. And I think even he could do better. But it's good and solid. 7.5 out of 10. So, Domination featuring Twisted, Boondocks, and Blaze, Ya Dead Homie. So, this one, I try not to judge tracks based on my expectations, but this one definitely could have been better. I mean, this is an epic lineup, but it's not an epic song. So, with that said, you know, I want to like it, and I do like it, but I don't love it. 6.5 out of 10. Go wild. So this one is kind of the, you know, you gotta have a sexual, you know, / romance track, you know, on every album, or at least that's what a lot of artists think. You gotta appeal to the ladies as well as the men. And I've never really related to this stuff that much. It's just, it's not what I listen to music for, especially this type of music. But I'm cool with it. Different strokes for different folks. And I've certainly heard much worse as far as this type of song goes. So I'm gonna give that one a 6 out of 10. Moving right along. I Don't Like Your Face featuring Jamie Madrox. Now, this was the track I bought the album for, and it was my first Lex the Hex Master purchase. Now, I wasn't sold on him until I saw the, like, wasn't sold on him completely until I saw this video. And I was like, okay, I'm sold. This is fire. This is great. Great! And it's just, it hits so hard. It's kind of deceiving that it's listed as featuring Jamie Madrox, because he's just on the chorus. And not only is he just on the chorus, he's just on the background of the chorus, like background vocals. It's like a layered chorus, you know. And after 1,000 listens, I'm still not entirely sure what Jamie is saying, because it's like in the background. But it's such a hot track. Oh my God, it's a hot track. I love it. And you know, the crowd always gets super hype whenever he plays this one. So good. So good. 10 out of 10. All day, son. Disgusting featuring Twisted. And here we go again. Epic lineup. Lex and Twisted. I mean, come on. You know, but it's disappointing. It's just, it's not that great. Now, you know, don't get me wrong. This whole album is solid. I can listen to this whole thing without really skipping any tracks, but I just expect more from these guys when they're together, and it's kind of weak, you know, for the standards that all three of these guys have set for themselves. I feel like this one was rushed. I'm gonna say this is a 5 out of 10. Moving right along. Offbeat. It's pretty cool. It's not the most memorable track, but it's pretty cool. You know, I like it. And I don't have a whole heck of a lot to say about it. The beat is, you know, catchy. You know, it's bouncy. You know, not too bad at all. 7 out of 10, but that might be a little generous. Army of One. Now, this was a track that they also made a video for. And, you know, it's pretty cool. You know, I quoted it in the intro to this track. That was the beginning of it, basically. Jamie Madrox does the spoken word. If you're not fucking with this, you're not fucking with nothing. And that's pretty much how they feel. You know, they're, you know, Majik Ninja isn't so conceited that you should be the only, that they should be the only thing you listen to, but, you know, they should definitely be in your rotation because they are the future and they're also the present. And the artists on the label are also the past of this genre. And they're going on to do bigger and better things. As for the track itself, you know, it's a good feel-good track. The, you know, the chorus hits and, you know, you're feeling it, it's good stuff. The verses are a little forgettable though. You know, nothing too crazy. 7 out of 10. My House, featuring Chris Rivers and Billy Danz of MOP. Like, I'm sorry if I'm not getting this name right. I'm not familiar with this group or this guy. So, sorry if I got it wrong. Anyway, killer track. One of the standouts of the album, which is always nice when they don't make a video out of a solid track like this. It's like a nice little reward for buying the album. You get something good and solid that you weren't necessarily going into it knowing about. And this track is good. 9 out of 10 easily. Easily 9 out of 10. Dance in Eternity. You know, this is a, you know, more mellow, artsy-fartsy type of track. Which, you know, this type of track is almost always at the end of an album because, you know, they want to give you a lasting memory of the album. They want you to feel good about what you just heard. And, you know, it's pretty good. I think it's, you know, that type of track to close out an album. And there's still one more track after this one, but it's a cliche at this point, especially in this genre. And I always appreciate it when an artist does something different to close out an album. Even if it's a swing and a miss, I still respect them for doing something different. So, with that said, I'm going to say 7 out of 10 for Dance in Eternity. Go Forth is also an uplifting track, but it's like motivational, inspirational speaking. And it's always, if, you know, this type of song always has a double whammy of an impact when it's coming from a, you know, a minority. And Go Forth, Tomorrow's Not Promise, so, you know, be real, be present. I forget the exact wording, but I like the message. It's like, go get yours, get out there and make stuff happen for yourself. You know, I'm proof that it can be done, you can do it, so do it. And I love that type of message. I feel that on such a strong level. And the song's not bad either. It's a good song. I would say 8 out of 10. Now, that's all of the tracks on this album. I've given a lot of the tracks average to above average ratings, but this is one of those albums that is stronger than the sum of its parts. You know, everything flows together and it gives you a nice roller coaster of emotions and feelings. So to me, it's somewhere between an 8 and a 9 all day. And I want to say it's closer to a 9. This is a classic album. And when I met Lex in St. Louis, I told him that. It's like, I'm really feeling that contact that you were doing. Good stuff, man. So yeah, let's just go right down the middle, call it 8.5 out of 10 for the final product. With that, this video is a wrap. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Check back every day for new videos. Peace out.